Thank you, Rich, for that lovely introduction. That's really touching. I'm going to tear up here. It is really nice to see all you guys. I was going to thank a few people and everyone. I know so many people here who've been here over the years, and I see new faces, and that's amazing. Do want to thank Demos, where I've been a part for more than 10 years. Rich, of course, who I've known for 10 years. 10 years becomes just so... so little, especially when you write a book that's over 100 years. It actually makes 10 years not seem so long. But Lauren, for being a part of this, you know, we've talked a lot on television. We just met last week, and so it's really nice that you know, she's here, and Yahoo Finance is behind this as well. Celeste Velducci has been my publicist for over 10 years. Jamie Leifer, who, and the amazing people at Public Affairs of the Nation, who put so many media hits and events, and have been working around the clock together. Alex Almond, who's in the back there, who is at Demos and who helped me do research for three of the chapters in this book, which is like a mere 200 pages or so. Six. They used to be three. They're divided on the 10s through the 30s, which was a very critical part of the book, and spent a lot of nights and weekends and gave up a lot of time to do that. Any of these books take a phenomenal amount of time. There's many more people I could thank. So if I've missed someone, we'll talk later. But anyway, thank you also.
All right. So, and you have a packed house. Way to pack a house, Nomi. And I'm sure everyone wants to hear about the book. So without further ado, let's talk about the book, because it is very comprehensive, as you guys know. It's very thorough, encyclopedic. So much work went into this. Let's just start with the title, All the President's Bankers, The Hidden Alliances That Drive American Power. So Nomi, what is this book? Is this another book about bankers being bad? What were you trying to do here?
I've written those and many articles on that. But what I really did in this book is took a look more at the relationships of people that drive this country, of the sort of anatomy of the power structure of this country. And it's not always so big. A lot of it starts in families, at marriages, in social clubs, on yachts, at Harvard, so what I wanted to do is really look at the presidents and the bankers, and how the alliances, which is a subtitle, but also the personal character of their relationships throughout the decades, because the character of their relationships is what marked the policies that America took through world wars, through financial crises, through social policies, through so much things in between for over a century. And I picked a century. I picked Teddy Roosevelt to start in 1907, because that was the time when J.P. Morgan and Teddy Roosevelt, who had a personal relationship, worked together to save the city from the panic of 1907. But in that alliance, we have a history now where when the bankers are called upon by the president to do something, or they ask the president to do something, it happens. And that alliance occurred and started under Teddy Roosevelt at what I call in the beginning of the book the start of financial capitalism, as opposed to productive or industrial capitalism that had occurred before that period. When Teddy Roosevelt was a trust buster, he did not bust the bank trusts, he busted other things. And that really started the ball rolling. But it was also because they knew each other. They had this trust and this bond that was way outside elections. It was way outside what's going on in the streets, and that really pervaded a lot of the research that happened. So the book's really about the character of power between presidents and bankers, not just about bankers.
Right. And let's kind of set up what the context is that you start this book with a Big Six that is not unlike the Big Six today, but it's not exactly the Big Six today, and some of these key power players, bankers, and their families. What are the key ones that we need to know about before we get into some of this history?
Yeah, you know, I mentioned J.P. Morgan. That was certainly a big player, and the family, and we have a J.P. Morgan Chase on like every corner in Manhattan. It's sort of there's Starbucks and there's Chase's. So the legacy of that family has certainly continued. but many men who ran that bank over time had a major, and we'll talk, I'm sure, in more detail, had a major place in dictating financial policy through World War I, through World War II, and so forth. So certainly J.P. Morgan. The Aldrich family, Winthrop Aldrich, was the head of Chase in the 30s in the Great Depression. His father was a man named Nelson Aldrich, who was the man who took a bunch of bankers to Jekyll Island to bang out the rules for the first Federal Reserve. His son, Winthrop Aldrich, was head of Chase for 2 decades. His great-nephew was Nelson Rockefeller, who was a 4-time governor of New York City and a vice president. And his other great-nephew was David Rockefeller, who was in banking for quite a number of decades. Y'all know the name. And also ran Chase himself for a couple of decades. So the Aldriches and Rockefellers also intermarried a lot. And then there was another family, the Stillmans, that basically ran National City Bank, which is now part of Citigroup, which is one of the big 6 banks today. And they all sort of intermarried a lot. At one point, you know, 2 of the daughters of the Stillmans married 2 of the sons of John D. Rockefeller. They created Stillman Rockefellers, and they ran Citibank at various times during the decade. So those are 4 of the main families on the banking side. And then politically, of course, we have the Roosevelts, we have the Kennedys, we have the Bushes through today.
And then before we get into some of the history, I also want you to kind of explain a little bit of your process, because you spent time in all of these presidential libraries, you unearthed all of these personal letters between bankers and presidents. It's a super well-researched book. So tell us a little bit about the process of spending all that time in presidential libraries.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't talk to anybody I knew for like 2 years. that was part of it. So that there was a lot of emails back, you know, sort of emails back saying, you know, sorry, writing a book, talk to you in 2013 or something. But what I did was I sort of mapped out the presidential archives across the country, and based on where there were cheap flights, I didn't go by decade, I sort of went by flight groups. I started to sort of map myself around America. I actually started in the 60s. I started in Austin, Texas, where I also have a brother, so that helped, but with the LBJ Library, and actually visited that library 3 times throughout the period, because it was just a fascinating interplay of bankers and a president who were both so intense with respect to the political power they wanted, but also knew how to work each other to actually do some good things for the country as well. And it was just a fascinating period. I spent time in Abilene, Kansas, where nobody spends time at the Eisenhower Library. It was me and some guy looking up something about cattle ranching or something, and how Eisenhower used to have a farm. So there was time spent there. I was in Independence, Missouri, Truman Library. If you notice, he was one of the most humble sort of, you know, he was a real accidental president, and he was one of the sort of humble guys. You know, he went back to live at his old little white house on the same street, actually it was across the street from where my hotel was, after he was president, and he didn't go on speaking tours making like tons of money. He just sort of donated back to his library, but I spent time there. So I basically just went around, and when you go to an archive, I don't know if any of you have done that kind of research, but basically, you know, you have to go in advance and say what folders you want to open, and there's all these classifications that FDR created back when he was president for our National Archives. They've changed since Reagan. Now it's really hard to get information. I had to file FOIAs. I had to do all sorts of things. The Clinton Library still hasn't gotten back to me on a ton of stuff I've asked them for. So it does stop at some point in time, but it was pretty rigorous, and I was always looking for these. The big 6 bankers of any period relative to the president, and I didn't know what I would find in any one archive. I didn't know that I would find like all of these relationships. Some I knew, you know, some stuff is out there, but I was opening boxes that like literally had not been opened, as well as ones that had been for different reasons. And so it was, to me, there was a lot of surprises that came out of it.
Which we're going to start hearing about. So you touched on Teddy Roosevelt and the trust busting and the beginning of this era of financial capitalism. But let's go back to that early era to kind of set the stage, because you have, in the late 1800s, you actually have J.P. Morgan himself at one point bailing out the U.S. Treasury. You have the Panic of 1907. You have Teddy Roosevelt and the trust busting. So set up what the relationship was between bankers and the presidents at that time.
Yeah, the bankers had more money than the Treasury at that time. There wasn't an issuance of debt. You know, there wasn't a Federal Reserve to buy $4.5 trillion worth of debt to subsidize the banking system like we have today. There was all the money, all the gold, everything was really at the major banks, and whoever ran the banks really ran American finance more than the Treasury Department ran American finance. So when there were runs on gold, you know, if it, you know, at the time from France or from different places in Europe, J.P. Morgan was the guy who was given credit for bailing out in some of the panics before 1900 the country, and he would be called upon to do that. And in the panic in 1907, that happened again. The Treasury Department did kick in $25 million to stop this panic, which was a lot at the time, nothing like what it does now. But also, J.P. Morgan kicked in 25. It wasn't his money. It turned out he asked Stillman, I mentioned Stillman before, to ask Rockefeller if they could sell some Standard Oil shares in order to make money, in order to save the banks, in order for J.P. Morgan to look good. So it wasn't even like he was really doing it, but he did get the credit for it in the press and the New York Times, and Teddy Roosevelt in his memoirs did say that it stopped a bigger catastrophe. But there was really a sense that the bankers were part of... Yeah, they were part of Washington. They're still part of Washington, but then it was a much tighter personal difference.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then out of the panic of 1907, this is when the idea really becomes strong that, okay, we need a central bank. The bankers wanted it, some key lawmakers wanted it, and the presidents were behind it, first Taft and later Wilson. So talk about how that was hatched. Jekyll Island, the story of these bankers and some lawmakers in this elite island getaway, you know, hatching the Federal Reserve behind closed doors. Is that a conspiracy?
No, that happened. But what I discovered, I actually went to Jekyll Island, and Megan Kiefer, who's somewhere in the back, went with me with a camera. And there's some footage that Celeste helped edit as well online about some of my... interviews there with John Hunter, who runs the archives at Jekyll Island. But before Jekyll Island happened, Nelson Aldrich was the head of the Senate Finance Committee, and he had been for years working on this notion, along with some of the bankers at the time and some of the senators, of having a central bank. And before the panic, or during the panic of 1907, two players wanted that central bank. The bankers wanted it after the panic so they wouldn't have to put up any of their money or pretend to put up any of their own money. In the event of another panic. Taft wanted it, and later Wilson wanted it, because it was a way to solidify the currency, the dollar of America, because before that, different banks had been issuing different notes. There wasn't a real sense of one entity could issue one currency, and therefore one entity couldn't compete with, say, the pound, which could be issued by the central bank in England, or the franc, which could be issued by the central bank in France. We didn't have that. So politically, there was a want for a central bank to have more power and more currency dispersed throughout the world to use as a chip for that power. And then the banks wanted it to help themselves. The meeting at Jekyll Island wasn't going to happen at first. We wouldn't even know about Jekyll Island except for the fact that Nelson Aldrich was hit by a trolley car on Madison Avenue in New York. And what happened was, he was here talking to some bankers, and his son was going to be running a large bank, Chase. He was running another banker, senior at the time anyway. And he came to New York to gather, and he had been a couple of years of information on central banks and what the bankers wanted from the Stillman family and the Morgans and so forth. And he was going to put this plan together for the Senate. And he got hit by a trolley car. And he was convalesced up in Winthrop Aldrich's townhouse, you know, sort of on the, you know, mid-east side there, which was near FDR's townhouse, which was on 65th Street. So there's all these kind of townhouses where they all kind of hung out. And Morgan, behind the scenes, was like, you know, you kind of have to get this done. But the way power really works is you don't have to say that. J.P. Morgan wasn't at the meeting at Jekyll Island. He sent people. And he sent people who had been working with Aldrich, including James Stillman's lieutenants and so forth, to Jekyll Island on his membership card. Because the way to get to Jekyll Island at the time, I mean, I don't know if any of you have been there, but there's sort of a, now there's a road that goes into this island, but at the time it was literally an isolated place where even boats that came down were changed over. There was watch people at the top. There were sort of rich, you know, bankers and other industrialists that would come to the shores of this island and be escorted by butlers and seven servants per one person to sort of hang out there during the Christmas months. And that's what Morgan thought, you know, this would be a good place for them to hide away during the November months, into Thanksgiving, because that was before the holiday season for the elite family, so it would be quiet there. So between the trolley car, and Morgan saying, you got to get this done. That's basically what happened. They did go to Jekyll Island. They did bang out a plan. On the way back, the train ride back inland up from Jekyll Island through New Jersey, or down, sorry, well, my geography's bad, by the way. I said I travel. Anyone who knows me knows I can't actually read a map. but anyway, on the way back to Washington, Nelson Aldrich was sick again, and he wasn't well enough to present this plan. So what happened was instead two bankers presented this plan that had been hatched at Jekyll Island to the Senate, which was something that I didn't know, that I had not read in The Creature Jekyll Island, but something that happened. So yes, there was a lot of coordination. Taft was very supportive of the plan. It didn't go through under Taft. The expectation was it couldn't go under a Republican president, but when a Democratic president came in, which was Wilson, a version of that same plan was passed under Wilson. And when it was passed, and when Wilson signed it, he assigned two of the bankers who were at Jekyll Island positions in the Board of Governors in Washington at the Fed, and one ran the New York Fed, which was the more powerful Wall Street-oriented arm of the Fed. So two of the five bankers that were at Jekyll Island were in two of the beginning posts of the Fed, appointed by Wilson.
And just to pick up on one point there, which was that when Nelson Aldrich, the lawmaker, was ill, the bankers literally went to Washington and prepared the summary of what happened at Jekyll Island and this plan for the Fed. You wouldn't see that today, you would hope,
right?
That personal level,
right,
of involvement by bankers. So we'll get to this a little later, but just can you tell us when the relationship changed from being a very personal one between bankers and Washington to a more kind of codified, professional almost one?
Yeah, I mean, a lot of these families, the Aldriches, the Rockefellers, the Roosevelt, they sort of died out in terms of running their institutions somewhere around the 70s and then into the 80s, things changed. So although the legacy names of the institutions they created still exist, the families weren't really running them. So that changed the nature of things. And then lawyers and lobbyists and stuff, they needed, like, a job. And so what we have now is the conversations that would have happened on a very tight basis, like you go to Washington, you present my plan, now have, like, you know, 200 lobbyists and lawyers and various minions of people in between arguing little points of any plan. So even anything that gets created today is magnitudes more complicated and less useful than anything that was created back then, whether it was a good law or a bad law. I hear it today, there's just so much more noise in between. Equal, yeah, power, just more noise.
And then we have the Fed. The Fed is established. Then things get crazy again. We have the crash of 1929. Bankers were involved in a lot of the speculation that led to the crash. They also were very involved in dealing with it in the aftermath and in the run-up to it. What was the role of bankers, particularly the Big Six? And then also the perspective, what was the government role?
Yeah, after the Fed was created, and of course we had a world war in between, and after the war there was a sense of more sort of isolationism with respect to the economy and finance, and a laissez-faire attitude, not that there hadn't been one already, but even more so towards banking and finance in general. And there was no sort of outside force like a war once the 20s came into play to keep anyone in line or pretend to be unified or nationalistic or patriotic. So a lot of these same bankers saw ways to make money out of that post-war period, and that was accompanied by three presidents who didn't really want to impose a lot of restrictions on what they were doing either. So, you know, you had Hoover, and you had Harding and Coolidge and Hoover, and none of them were particularly interested in reining in any sorts of practices that were happening, because partially from a foreign policy perspective, America had now come out of a war. It was more powerful than, yeah, certainly the European countries that had been in the war. It had more economic power as well as more political power than it had before the war, and it wasn't interested in losing that. So the policy of the bankers, who weren't interested in losing that either and wanted to expand upon it, and politically, Harvard and Coolidge and Hoover wanted to expand upon that, and that created this era of speculation that ultimately led to the crash in 1929. It wasn't just speculation, it was a lot of illegality and fraud and pumping up stocks and pumping up trust. us and lying to this American public that had gotten on the same page as banking even after the panic of 1907, because they believed that the war unified the country. Not saying everyone, but there was a sense everybody was at least sort of on the same page, and that was kind of manipulated to an extent where individual investors were now being hosed by a lot of fraudulent, shady deals, and bankers front running are basically trading in front of the individuals and using their money to do a lot of speculation nationally and internationally.
And then in the crash, or right as things were really falling apart, the bankers banded together to try to figure out how to save themselves, their shares.
Exactly. So 22 years after they had sort of done the same thing in Morgan's library, they did the same thing at the Morgan Bank on 23 Wall Street. And they were called together by a man named Tom Lamont, who was the acting chair of Morgan. At this point, J.P. Morgan had died, and his son Jack was running the bank. But mostly Jack was like traveling around and doing, he just wasn't really interested in working per se. He's a Morgan. Tom Lamont took over and sort of had this crisis management moment on Black Thursday in 1929 in October, and he called the other five bankers from what was then the Big Six banks, which was from Chase, which was from National City Bank, First National Bank, which became part of now what is now Citigroup, and Bankers Trust, and said, we're going to, again, put in our own money. The difference at this meeting took 20 minutes. In 20 minutes, they're like, okay, we're going to put in our money. We're going to buy some stocks, which really is kind of a hose in itself, because we're going to buy stocks to prop up the value so that people will buy them, and we'll figure out what happens later. Now, at this meeting, for example, Al Wiggin, who is now head of Chase, was short Chase shares. So he knew that things were going south, even though the market was buckling, but he was even shorting his shares more. So he's at this meeting where he's having conversation with these other bankers about how we need to save everybody and ourselves. He's agreeing with them to put in $25 million each now to save the markets and to buy shares in the companies in which they had exposure, like U.S. Steel, and he's in the meantime completely short on the other side. And he's got a bunch of little tax deals going on. He's got little setups in Canada and stuff where his family have different names on these little companies that also own shares. So all the other like shady stuff is going on in between while they're sitting in this room trying to figure out how to save things. But in 20 minutes, they decide to do it. The call goes over to the New York Stock Exchange, which is just like, you know, across the street, basically, catty corner. If you go down to Wall Street from the Morgan Bank, they go up the back stairs, they sort of put in their, they've got the money behind, and they start to buy, and that shoots the market up for a day. New York Times is happy, magazine, everybody's happy, you know, there's cheering going around, you know, we've diverted this disaster, and of course, that was just the beginning of the disaster, which took over 90% of the market out, and created a Great Depression, 25% more unemployment over the next 4 years.
Yeah, so after that, it's no surprise that there was a push to rein in the banks. And this is from this push where we get Glass-Steagall, which was the regulation to separate the commercial aspect of the banks, the safe part of banks, just deposit and lending, from the more speculative aspects of the bank, the part that could underwrite securities and that could speculate and do all that sort of thing. What's so interesting about this is this was done under FDR, and it had the support of some of the most powerful key bankers, including Winthrop Aldrich, who was the son of the Fed architect Nelson Aldrich, who ran, what did he run, Chase?
Yes.
And so, also the chairman of National City Bank. So how did this get done? Why were some key bankers on board?
Okay, so as I mentioned, Al Wiggin was a crook, and he was running Chase, right? So what happened was FDR came in, and it wasn't that he didn't like banks, he just preferred bankers that he knew to be in the positions running them. So Winthrop Aldrich actually came in place of Al Wiggin. Al Wiggin was sort of summarily let go. There was some debate over some huge pension package he would get. They, you know, that sounds familiar, etc. But anyway, it was discovered later he was a crook. But Winthrop Aldrich and James Perkins, who came in to run National City Bank, also a friend of FDR's, came in as sort of the good apples. So when FDR said in his inaugural speech, you know, we have nothing to fear but fear itself, that he explained that there was, you know, what had happened in the banks, and he sort of told people that it was due to some bad players. He didn't exactly say it that way, but the perception that he gave to the public was that confidence could be and should be instilled in these banks, and it was a question of who was going to be running them and how they were going to be run. 2 days later, he has a secret meeting in Washington with James Perkins and then later Winthrop Aldrich to talk about how they're going to go about separating their banks. Now, the Glass-Steagall Act would not be passed for another few months after that. So this is before the Glass-Steagall Act that separated banks was going to be passed. It was just sort of being debated still in the Senate, and there was a thing called the PCORA hearings, which were examining all these shady dealings, like Al Wiggins setting up, you know, shady things for his family and tax evasions and so forth in Congress, while outside of Congress, FDR was actually talking to these new bankers about how this would be done in practice. And Winthrop Aldrich in particular took out a front page article in the New York Times to promote the Glass-Steagall Act before it was passed. And he actually gave up his bank, as did James Perkins, in that he split them up before the legislation. And as a result, it gave FDR more political power, and it happened before the PCORA hearings were done. So all this stuff is still going on in Washington, and we're talking about how these bankers have been bad, et cetera. Meanwhile, the new ones, and the ones that would be there for quite some time, James Perkins died young, but Winthrop Aldrich, who was head of Chase for quite some time after that, were actually working with FDR, which I didn't, you know, which is not something you would think. Well, you certainly wouldn't think that would happen today, because it doesn't. But back then, it was this issue of they knew each other personally, and they also knew Winthrop Aldrich. It wasn't like he didn't want to be rich. He was already rich. It wasn't like he didn't want to expand his bank. He wanted Chase to be bigger than the Morgan Bank. I mean, they were competitive back then. But he also thought that you could do both. You know, you could have a more stable general economy and financial structure, as FDR obviously also believed, and you could make money. And that's really one of the impetuses for why the Glass-Steagall Act was passed across party lines with an enormous amount of support by the Republican and the Democratic Party.
One aspect of that, too, though, was that the bankers that supported it saw it as a competitive advantage that they could break up the most powerful bank, which was the Morgan Bank. So did that play a role?
Well, yes, and think about it. Morgan Bank was very powerful in World War I. It basically financed like 75% of the private financing that went to the Allies went through the Morgan Bank. And they were in and out of well, that's a separate story. But it's a really good story on World War I and how Wilson got together with Jack Morgan to sort out the war. But that wasn't the question. The question was about
talk about whatever
about what happened after
just
that.
Saw that as a competitive advantage, an opportunity,
yes,
essentially to make the most powerful bank less powerful.
Right, and the upshot of that is we have J.P. Morgan Chase now. Aldrich's gamble, if you want to call it that. I mean, he was a financial guy, was paid off for him. The Morgan Bank became slightly less powerful, though resurrected in World War II. The Chase Bank became, and still is, much more powerful in terms of its personal and political and financial relationships with the White House. And it still exists today, and it's the most powerful bank in the United States, if not the world. So it worked out to do that.
Yeah. And then just one other point about FDR. Talk a little bit about him, because he was able to get a lot of financial reform done. We got the FDIC, we got the Securities and Exchange Commission, we got Glass-Steagall done. He was also of their ilk. He was from their world. But then at the same time, at certain points, because he served four terms, he was considered a traitor to his class, particularly when he really hiked taxes on the rich. So explain that dynamic, like how he got some of these things done and his connections to this world versus also being a traitor.
Yeah, I mean, he certainly was connected to that world, going back again to Morgan. James Roosevelt, who was FDR's father, and J.P. Morgan created the Metropolitan Club in New York, which was a place where, you know, sort of that ilk would talk about the affairs of the day and what should be done and so forth. So they were very on the same page going into that. You know, he knew the Aldriches, the estate that he had up in Hyde Park, which is also where the library is now, and then they started, if you've been there, but you know, the library is there for research, and there's a museum there, and his home is open, and so forth. They were very on the same page, and what happened into the sort of recession of 37 and 38 was that they thought, okay, you know, we've been on your side, we're your friends. You know, now you're kind of going a little bit too far with all these extra organizations you want to create. You know, the regulation was fine. It helped save us. We restored some confidence. The market went up a little bit in the mid-30s, and now it's kind of going back down, and we're not really a fan of what you're doing. So they retracted their support because it just didn't work well for them. They gave that support back into World War II, because now they were going to go back and sort of replay the role that they had in financing and expansion pre and post war that they had in World War I.
Yeah, and let's talk about the wars, because both World War I and to a greater extent World War II were a boon for the banks, both financially but also from a public relations perspective, because during those times the public perception went from being one of, oh, the bankers are just trying to screw us over and they're horrible to us, to one of, oh, they're patriotic, and to some extent it did seem merited from some of the examples you give. So talk about the impact of the war on the banks, the both wars.
Yeah, so World War I, again, happened right after the Fed was created. Everything was fine. We're all on the same page. Now I get to do the... So Wilson calls Jack Morgan, now the son of J.P. Morgan, to the White House, having campaigned against the idea of money trusts and bankers, and there's all this, like, buzz around. There's tons of reporters go up to Washington, and they're like, what's going on? Is this some new plan? You know, did you lie to us and stuff? And they come out of this meeting. Jack Morgan's notoriously quiet. All the Morgans were very quiet about talking to the press, so he just says, you know, ask Wilson. Wilson comes out and says, Woodrow Wilson, and says, you know, I called him here at my pleasure. Well, it turned out that was a month before the war broke out in Europe, and that pleasure had been to discuss financing. And as I mentioned, ultimately, the Morgan Bank was given the role of financing the war and worked very closely with the Treasury Department to raise war bonds, as well as the Department of Defense, to figure out strategically what allies got what supplies and when and how they would be funded. So that helped them, because their European counterparts, with whom they might have been competitive, are now in a war, and it's on their soil, or near their soil, and there's nothing here on this soil, and it gave the American banks and bankers a real power position. It also allowed them to open their doors and get more customers. The bigger banks had more power, had more closeness to the president, and were selling war bonds through to their customers. A little bit less in World War I than World War II. By the time World War II came along, you know, you walked into a National City Bank and there were ads all over the place about, you know, being patriotic and supporting and buying war bonds, and they sold many, many, many more war bonds through the campaigns of these banks than they would have anyway. So it made FDR and his Treasury Secretary happy, because there was extra funding coming into the war, and it made the bankers, particularly the big banks, who were involved in these discussions about how to even structure war bonds, like what kind of bonds would entice what kind of investors. You know, these were the conversations that were going on between Henry Morgenthau, who was the Treasury Secretary, and Aldrich, and some of the other bankers, because they wanted to make sure that they could make money off of it, but they also wanted to make sure they could win the war. And so there was kind of a combined common interest on that. And the start of the everyman, even National City Bank, that was involved, the head of National City Bank was head of the War Bond Council that was created and worked with Henry Morgenthau, the Treasury Secretary, and it was their combined idea, and they knew each other from way back, it was their combined idea to expand the reach of who would be buying bonds and how they would connect them into accounts they would open up at these banks, so that more people could be tapped,
right,
to raise money for the war. And after the war, all these people are your customers. Now you've tapped them. They opened up an account and bought a war bond in your branch, and so now they're your customer. And so they felt it was a patriotic duty, but now it's also a financial client, and so they grew from there.
Right, and we have about 10 minutes before we get to questions, and I know that you want to talk about the 60s, so I want to get to that and also try and bring this full circle to some modern day stuff. So let's just touch on the Cold War. The Cold War, there are some of the same opportunities with the Marshall Plan, which starts under Truman, and then it continues under Eisenhower. The bankers, key bankers, really wanted Dwight Eisenhower to be president. They personally tried to persuade him to run when he was commander of NATO. So why was that? And how did his doctrine of interventionism against the threat of spreading communism, how was that suited to Wall Street bankers? How essentially did the Cold War White House push align with the bankers' desires?
Well, so as I was saying, you know, after World War II, there's all this domestic concentration that has changed, and now the wars are over, so now it's time to expand internationally. And so it's easier to expand internationally if your financial policy is aligned with military policy. So Eisenhower's policy was to defend countries. Again, the Eisenhower Doctrine was to defend countries that could be inflicted by communism and protect them from a military and a trade perspective. And the trade perspective was what the bankers were most interested in, because if there was open trade with capitalist-leaning countries, they could make more money. If there's no trade or closed trade with communist countries, they're not going to make money out of that situation. And so they both aligned. And so a lot of branches from the big banks that were involved in also creating this policy with Eisenhower and with Truman started in little outposts. So for example, many banks opened branches in Cuba because they, before the missile crisis and before it sort of didn't work out for them, before Castro. But they opened branches because they thought that would be the funnel of banking into Latin America. It was going to be a stronghold, and U.S. military policy felt the same way until that changed under Kennedy. And then the same thing with Beirut in the Middle East. There was a number of banks that opened outposts in Beirut to be able to access, in the 50s, to be able to access the Middle East. And then that had issues and they retraced. But Eisenhower also sent a whole bunch of troops to protect Beirut for a moment, and that was mostly because a bunch of banks had just opened their branches there. So there was a kind of symbiotic relationship in terms of both expansion desires politically and of the banks, and that's kind of what happened into the Cold War.
Yeah, and then getting into the 60s, Wall Street had changed. 65% of the bankers were under 35. You're right, they had no memory of the Great Depression. They had very little memory of World War II. So this is the world that we're living in, when it seems that things kind of shift from being a little bit focused on what was good for the public and being pretty much focused on like the bank's ambition. And this is when John F. Kennedy becomes president. What was his relationship with the bankers?
Yeah, so again, there was a longstanding personal relationship, again, with Kennedy and some of the bankers at the time. John F. Kennedy's sister Kathleen, who died young, had met and slightly dated David Rockefeller in 1938, when Joe Kennedy, the father, had gone from being the first head of the SEC under FDR to being the UK ambassador for FDR in England. And they had a big coming out party for Kathleen, and David Rockefeller was there because he was going to the LSE, and John F. Kennedy was there, and they kind of met at that time. And then sort of that moved forward. By the time the 60s came along, just in general, you know, Mad Men adds the whole thing. Yeah, there was this younger group of people coming into these places. These families were starting to either do other things, or the patriarchs were dying out, or what have you. And all of this new blood was coming in, and they kind of really wanted to be for themselves. And they really weren't so aligned with what JFK wanted. For example, JFK, you're talking about Latin America, he didn't really want the extent of private capital going into these countries, or them being indebted by promises to the United States from an economic standpoint. But Rockefeller, David Rockefeller, who was rising within the Chase constellation, certainly wanted that. So their desires started being a little bit different. And Kennedy wasn't really as friendly with the bankers, even though he knew them in his first year and a half. He figured it out. Or he did what he thought was figuring it out in his next year and a half, but it took a while. And of course, LBJ was a huge friend to the bankers.
So let's talk about that, because things that Kennedy couldn't get done with banker support, you know, water right there. Lyndon B. Johnson could get the exact same thing done with banker support that Kennedy hadn't. Same thing, just different relationship with the bankers. So LBJ, how did he get the support of the bankers? They even supported his progressive Great Society programs, which is not what you would expect. So what was his secret sauce?
Did you guys see Bryan Cranston, anybody, on Broadway yet? In All the Way? I know you saw it. We saw it this weekend. It's awesome. You should see it if you can get a ticket, because he's just so good at embodying the politician that was LBJ. And LBJ just knew how to use people and make them feel good to get what he wanted to get done. And the bankers were no exception. So the bankers that had had slightly ornery relationships with John F. Kennedy were invited to his ranch and hung out with him, and he invited them to Washington. When David Rockefeller went off to talk to Khrushchev with his daughter Nina in the Soviet Union when they first opened a branch of a Chase Bank well before the Cold War was officially open, over, you know, came back and LBJ invited him to the White House to talk about policy with him. You know, he just made them feel good, and he didn't do regulations with respect to the banks, but he did when some of the bankers started to get a little ornery about the Great Society. He said, no, you know, I'm going to do this, and you're going to support this, and I will help you or stay out of your way for what you need to do. So again, it was that ability to sort of look at the public interest and promote some of the things that he promoted from a policy standpoint and get them on his page. You know, also he didn't bother them, but he also was very good at establishing personal relationships, though he had not grown up with, you know, the sort of Eastern establishment, Harvard type of societal connections that some of the other presidents had with them.
Yeah, and they supported him through much of the Vietnam War. Very symbiotic, it sounds like.
Until they didn't.
Yeah. Until they didn't. Nixon had a really distant relationship with Wall Street. So what was the dynamic going on there between Wall Street and Nixon, particularly as, you know, some big things were going on? He closed the gold window once and for all, and that was impacted by bankers. That was what they wanted at the time. So what was that?
Yeah, the whole gold standard thing, when we went off of gold, it was mostly because, it goes again back to Rockefeller and Walter Wriston, who was running Citibank at the time, wanted us not to have any peg for our currency, because it's much easier to expand and to trade and to lend and to speculate if you don't have to put anything down. You know, so if you don't have collateral, if you don't have gold that you need to like put in safety somewhere, you can just sort of have currency created. It's a lot easier to trade, and so that's what they wanted to do. And Nixon bought into that and took credit for it, but bought into that notion and had a lot of conversation about that. But he wasn't very friendly with them. For example, he wanted David Rockefeller to be his Treasury Secretary, but he didn't ask him personally. It came through one of his guys. And so when the request came to David Rockefeller, he was like, no. I mean, he was just offended. Walter Wriston as well, who was running National Citibank or Citibank at the time, also was asked to be the Treasury Secretary and also said no. So they really just didn't want to play with Nixon. And then, of course, with Watergate and everything else, they, you know, felt that they had done that right. And
yeah. So we have a couple minutes, so let's kind of fly through modern banking. Because the 80s, Reagan does not have a very personal relationship with the bankers, but they're kind of on the same page because they want the same things. And you have deregulation, you have the savings and loan crisis, which was brought about by deregulation in part. And this is when you have a lot of lobbyists doing the bidding of bankings as opposed to bankers doing them themselves. So kind of what marks this period of modern banking? How would you characterize it?
Yeah, one of the things that happened under Reagan was Bush. And and the Bush family actually was a banking family as well as a political, they still are, you know, a banking family as well as a political family. So they were involved in the SNL crisis, longer story, it's in the book, but they were involved in the SNL crisis, but also George Bush's grandfather had developed an investment bank back in 1900 that had ultimately became part of Merrill Lynch. The CEO of Merrill Lynch became Ronald Reagan's Treasury Secretary. That was not an accident. There was connections going on there. And he brought with him the philosophy of deregulation and the enabling of different types of financial institutions to be able to do each other's, particularly if they were large, to do each other's types of trading and to sort of start to reduce the binds of the Glass-Steagall Act. And so it was actually Bush who had a task force that met monthly, or at least they sent out reports monthly. There's you go to the Bush Library and there's stacks of these reports that I doubt anybody ever read, but they were, you know, really thick reports that were monthly reports about their deregulation sort of position at the time. So that was what was going on behind the scenes. And of course, you know, when Clinton came on board, he just got it done a lot better, and he had Robert Rubin on his side, and he had the legitimacy of Wall Street come in through now sort of the Goldman partnership. But it was pretty much building on the same blocks of Ronald Reagan and George Bush,
yeah,
and then through Clinton, and that's what we have today. I mean, Obama's cabinet was sort of Clinton's cabinet, and so the continuity there in terms of what these big six banks today have done and can do, and what the bankers who run them have done and can do is again a continuation. So I don't spend a lot of time. You know, the 80s through the end of the book is. I mean, it's long. I mean, it's a fat book, but it's a lot of it runs into each other because you see some of the same policies just being articulated by different people, but literally using some of the same words. Robert Rubin was using the same words in front of the Senate that Nicholas Brady, who was George Bush's Treasury Secretary, was using with respect to American competitiveness and how we need to have, you know, the banks unchained. I mean, he used these really sort of harsh, dramatic words, and they used the same words. It didn't matter, you know, which president or which person. It just sort of the policies kind of shown through.
Right, and so that's where we are today. Before we open it up to questions, what's the lesson? Because you end your book saying our choice is simple: either we break the alliances or they'll break us. How do you figure? And also, how does this impact democracy? Our democracy? How would you say our democracy works? Very well? Not very well? What's the antidote as well?
Well, right now the big six banks control 84% of bank deposits in this country, of all the banks, 85% of assets, and 96% of derivatives. So they're pretty powerful from the standpoint of the sheer capital over which they command. They're more powerful over the sheer amount than perhaps they were in the early part of the 20th century. The personal relationships have become a little bit more functional. There isn't a sort of, you do this for me, I do this for you. There's sort of just, I want to do this. And then the government sort of has just been supportive of that, which is why we have such a bailout and subsidization policy, and why the Fed has like $4.5 trillion worth of bonds on its books that do nothing for people and just really support a lot of bad trading decisions that the banks have made. So when I say break the alliances, or, you know, before they break us, I'm kind of copying Louis Brandeis, who in 1910 wrote a book called Other People's Money. I wrote a book in 2004 called Other People's Money. It was not an accident, because he wrote that the money trust at the time, sort of the Morgan Constellation and all his friends, were basically rigging a lot of markets. They might not have been the same bank, but they were sort of trading within each other, creating demand, making it look like things were going on. And he thought that was dangerous for the stability of America, for the economy, for everybody as a whole, for finance, for everything. And now we're sort of, you know, 100 plus years after that, and it's worse. And so I just wanted to remind everybody of Louis Brandeis. You know, we don't call them money trusts, but you know, the alliances that have developed have not gone in the right direction. There have been times when they worked better for the public interest, and now they just simply don't work at all for the public interest. So that's what I mean by that. I don't think anything that happened after the 2008 crisis has fixed anything. There really has been no reform of any meaningful kind. And as I mentioned, those numbers are worse numbers than they were before 2008. And so that's a problem. What that says for democracy, well, whenever you have, you know, a small group of powerful players running the economy, running the decisions that relate to money and finance and trade and military, you don't really have a democracy. You know, one person, one vote, you know, few people, a conversation with the White House, you know, that doesn't equal a healthy democracy. And so that's the other reason we're breaking alliances. You know, yet we can vote, but the power is nowhere near in our favor. I think we all know that. But when you start to examine how that evolved and how these connections have worked over time, you see that we really have some serious questioning to do about what we even call ourselves.
Speaking of questioning, I'm sure the audience has many questions. Rich is going to help us out here. Nomi, thank you for all of that thoughtful insight from the book.
Thank you, guys. And so what we'll do is we'll open the audience for questions, and if you could be mindful of the fellow audience and ask concise, pointed questions, we'd be grateful. And so just show of hands. Yeah.
Hi.
If you'd like a microphone, say so. We'll give it to you.
Yeah. I mean, I'm going to pick up on sort of where Lauren is going, because it does seem a little bleak. You know, what I was looking at your book, I don't know how you got it done inside of 2 decades, much less the years that you spent on it. You must have been in archives and writing a lot of the day. I'm really, really impressed with that. But I guess I would use the word fault lines. It seemed like there were always fault lines. There were some rivalries, trying to, you know, break up Morgan, that, and some alignment with the interests of the country. And now it seems like the financial system just thinks the country and the citizenry is there to serve it.
Yeah.
And it's reflected in the lack of even investigation, much less prosecution. Even in the Reagan era, there were 1,000+ significant convictions. And now there isn't a single one. So, you know, it's a little daunting. From your historical analysis, can you maybe identify some fault lines that may help disrupt from the inside some of these things, or some historical trends you see maybe putting pressure from the inside? And maybe, and I know you've done a lot of work with progressive economic alternatives, maybe public banking and other things, you see some fault lines and opportunities happening outside of the banking industry that could put pressure on these alliances and I guess you could say the arrogance that they embody.
It's tough, because when you had the power, even through J.P. Morgan back in when he was the most powerful banker in the country, if not the world, they still felt that they mostly needed to sort themselves out. Whereas now we've seen that, yes, it's sort of like we have deposits, we have bailouts, we have a Fed that is giving us free money, we have a Fed that's buying all the crappy bonds that no one else will buy so that we can keep the money to do some other scary thing. There's no accountability from the other side of that. I mean, it's very bleak. It's you know, I get asked, what do you do? And I don't know. I mean, the last 2 books I wrote on this topic, It Takes a Pillage and Other People's Money, I ended them with these chapters about how, you know, we need to have people more aware, we need to have people work outside of the larger banks or put their money outside of large banks, we need a Glass-Steagall that actually works, we don't need a Dodd-Frank that's ridiculous, you know, that there's pressure. I mean, there are a few people in Washington, very few, you know, you have Elizabeth Warren, you have Bernie Sanders, who sort of get this and sort of push it, but they appear to be the minority. In FDR's time, you had bankers with slightly more of an ability to walk and chew gum, to basically see a public interest as well as a private interest, and today you don't, because all of this capital, all of these derivatives, all of this leverage happens outside of any association with America or any one individual nation. It just doesn't matter. You know, public banking or going to separate banks is one way to mitigate some power, but quite honestly, with 85% of the deposits in the world, you know, we could all move all of our accounts tonight, and unfortunately, it wouldn't make a dent, because those alliances still exist. President Obama and whoever sits in that seat and whoever sat in that seat for the last several presidencies hasn't been able to get anything remotely punitive done or even talk about it, and so. It's bleak. I mean, I don't think that Hillary Clinton or Jeb Bush or anybody's going to do anything really different. I mean, I don't think the pickings are very good out there with respect to changing that alliance. So, I mean, what's the solution? I don't know. I also saw NOAA this weekend. I mean, they had a big flood because there's a lot of greedy families sort of grabbing stuff. I don't know, but I mean, I'm serious. There might be I believe we have, just as I did at the end of Other People's Money in that period before this 2008 crisis, I believe that without changing, we will have another crisis. And maybe it takes a really, really bad crisis to get a somewhat conscientious shift in the leadership in Washington, as well as the leadership in the banking system, because we're kind of stuck with that dynamic. That's been the dynamic that has existed. But it kind of has to come from us being aware and us doing things, and also, unfortunately, from some like dire occurrence on the outside. Big fault line. I live in California. I understand fault lines. I'm huge. Yeah.
Well, hi, Nomi.
Hello.
So, following up on his question, do you see a solution possibly coming from the private sector in technology and maybe peer-to-peer lending? Or like we see Airbnb and Uber and some of these platforms that go out there and they provide a marketplace or a platform for people to reach each other. Do you think that could be a possible solution?
I think
something
that's very
like
healthy.
That, for example.
I think that's very, actually, that's a really good point. I think, you know, whether that diminishes the power of this political financial alliance is one thing, but using outside sources where people come together and where technology brings them together, I actually think that that's good. I'm a big fan of Airbnb, like all of those things. Because it also allows us to feel independent. I mean, we're technically a country about independence. It's like going to the Strand, because it's been, the local neighborhood bookstore for so many years. This is a good thing. And supporting, communities and small businesses within communities, I think is really important. So I also think it's local and it's community-based, and I also think that's a good point, it's technological. And I think that gives us power in our own lives, and I think that's important anyway, because maybe if we do feel more empowered, we'll feel better about, or we'll feel more empowered to actually voice these things rather than just be upset about them.
I wanted to ask a question on the other side of technology. Financial markets change very, very quickly now. There's a book, I hope you get the same publicity that it does, Michael Lewis's book on high-frequency trading. And one of the things he discusses is how when front-running was being prosecuted at the New York Stock Exchange, it was then being done in a slightly different manner in nondescript buildings in New Jersey through electronics. Do you think that at the pace of regulation and government oversight, the government can ever catch up at this point to the Airbnbs of the financial world that are changing so rapidly that you don't know what they are until they're passed?
If everyone here knows 1,000 people who will buy my book, I might make the numbers of Michael Lewis's book, so we'll just start out with that. Yes. Yes, I didn't fight with the table I was at CNBC yesterday, so that's they didn't fight with me. But anyway, no, I think that there's been a complete lack of competence and willingness to examine problems before they happen. In the case of high frequency trading, I mean, that's been going on forever. The technology's just gotten better. Al Wiggin was shorting his own company ahead of his customers while the market was going down. He was pretending to bring it back up. That's high frequency trading in 1929. And so there's been particularly recently, you mentioned, there was prosecutions in the SNL crisis. There was some sense of decorum, but the people that ran in the biggest banks never have gotten slammed. And they haven't gotten slammed today because of these relationships, because of the shared power, and so that's a problem. So you can prosecute maybe some high frequency trading operations, but you're not going to prosecute Jamie Dimon, who runs Chase, where JP Morgan Chase, where there's lots of little things like that happening all the time. And that policy comes from above. I mean, it's still a leadership thing. Yeah, the SEC is not being particularly good at being proactive at anything. The Department of Justice has basically washed its hands of everything that occurred in the 2008 crisis, saying, there was fraud, but you guys had nothing to do with actually causing it or managing it or directing your employees to do it. That had nothing to do. There's a complete leadership breakdown on both the banking side and on the political side. So that has to change, because it's not a question of looking for things that are wrong. It's a question of wanting to fix things to make them right, and that's not happening.
Okay, and Nomi, that's changed. Looking back after 29, I mean, you had a bank chairman, Charles Mitchell. He was indicted for tax evasion.
Yeah, he was.
And big bank heads, you know, had to step down because of their shenanigans at a 29. You know, that is very different now.
Yes. No. Now they just make more money.
So we have to begin to wrap up. Was there a question here that still? Okay. As this microphone goes back.
He's very loud. Okay, that's Greg Palast. Everybody, Greg Palast, the hat, the thing, there you go.
Two words, Obama and Diamond. Could you explain their relationship? And part B, which is just cheating by getting a second question, hedge funds and the political relationship with power structure. Jamie Dimon or Obama, what do you have to say?
Well, yes, some of you know, in 2009, New York Times came out with a piece that talked about Jamie Dimon being Obama's favorite banker. And that's usually related to being one of your main financial contributors, as well as someone who allows you to maintain and create more power for yourself, as well as someone who can get both money and influence consolidated for you around the street. And that was what Jamie Dimon did for Obama, as did Robert Rubin, as did the constellation that came out of Robert Rubin, helped get Obama elected. And the history of Morgan and Washington, and now JP Morgan Chase in Washington, has really been what's solidified the relationship, which is tight between Obama and Jamie Dimon. Every so often there's an article that says, oh, they had a falling out, you know, someone didn't contribute that year and all these things. But at the end of the day, this is a bank for which Washington policy is to keep it running, using the Fed, using the Treasury Department, using all of the connections, and keep Jamie Dimon absolved from any of the stuff that Al Wiggin had to deal with when he stepped down. So the relationship is pretty strong. I don't know what we'll know when all these archives come out. And again, I'm still dealing with Clinton's archives, so I could be talking to you guys in like 25 years. I hope, I hope I'm not looking at archives in 25 years. But I don't know about the conversations. You know, they've gone from nice, lovely, thoughtful letters to shooting emails and things that are redacted over the years as well. So it's very hard to know exactly. And I think you mentioned this in your book, really, some of the initial Chicago connections between Jamie Dimon and Obama back when he was thinking about running anywhere near the presidency. So these are long-standing ties, and it's something that many presidents have had with many bankers throughout the decades. Hedge funds are kind of it's kind of a separate book and a separate animal. So it could take a really long time. But it's important to note about hedge funds that they receive a lot of their money from these banks, whose deposits, which are ours, back the money that they're able to infuse into hedge funds. So there's, even though hedge funds are sort of outside a lot of regulations, and banks are supposed to be regulated better, though they are not, they are still connected in a lot of ways and with a lot of kind of partnerships and people investing from the top of one into the top of another, as well as today's social connections, you know, Hamptons Homes. And so I was on the CNBC, talking about the CNBC, we're talking about vacation homes at the end of this panel. I was like, the secondary vacation homes that are in the multi-million dollar bracket have been going up in price. Now, I'm sure this concerned you because you're all gonna go out and get one, but I think I just remember this story back at in the Hamptons where someone from Goldman and someone else from Goldman who were partners lived very near each other in these two very sort of large houses in the Hamptons, and one of the big fights they were having was over, I think, like 3.5 inches of beach space that was on one side versus the other side. So, and maybe there was a hedge fund manager on the other side of that who was also fighting, but it's connected.
Connected. So, Emily, are we done? Okay, Nomi's going to sign books, and thank you for coming and joining us.
Thank you so much. Thank you. And thank you, Lauren. Thank Lauren also. Did a great job coming out here. And Rich. And the Strand.